Hello and welcome to Gub Farm. I have a very interesting project today, and that is I'm going to build a Johnson Sue style bioreactor, but one that has the ability to handle about 50 ton of material. So here's the game plan at Gub Farm. Firstly, I'm planting trees, specifically hazelnut trees, so that I can get a cash crop every year from them. Between the trees, I am going to have pasture-fed chickens, so the chickens will be moved around the farm every day to fresh grass. The laying chickens will have to be wintered, and I estimate if I've got the number of chickens I expect to put on the farm, I will have to handle about maybe 50 ton of material, which is a mixture of chicken manure and woodchip to get the right compost mix. I've been thinking a lot about the design of the bioreactor, and whatever I come up with has to be scalable. Ideally, I want to keep it irrigated by natural rainfall, and I have to do all of this and meet waste regulations as well. So let's talk about the regulations. In Northern Ireland, there are two key areas you need to focus on. Firstly, the compost has to be prepared on an impermeable surface. Secondly, any effluent that comes off the compost, it has to be captured in a sump, a tank. So to address those points, I'm going to use plastic sheeting to create that impermeable membrane between the soil and the compost. I will then use a puddle pump and drop it into a sump, and I will pump any effluent that goes in there back into the compost. Going to start by digging a sump. Using loose blocks, I'm going to create a wall. I'm going to line the first 30-40 centimetres, and I'm going to put a puddle pump in the end to catch any water that runs away. So this is only a temporary structure to test how well the compost turns out. So key principles that I'm testing is the mixture of wood chip and chicken manure. I am testing natural irrigation. If it goes according to plan, I will create a 10 by 10 square meter area here with a concrete base and concrete walls running off into a tank. But first I have to find out if it's going to work. So what I'm going to do now is quickly test to see if the sump that I dug at the end will work to trigger the pump. As you can see, the plastic membrane is doing its job in terms of catching any runoff, including the rainwater. So I have a puddle pump. It is activated by this float. I'm just going to drop it into the sump now. Okay, you can see it working. Okay, good. I'm going to get some piping. I'm going to rig it up in such a way that I can recycle any effluent back into the compost. What I'm going to do next is put a row of blocks down on top of this plastic, because that's enough to capture the effluent. And then I'm going to build it up to about 80 centimeters. One of the reasons why I want to keep the plastic low is find the balance between capturing the effluent and creating pathways to allow the compost to breathe. I understand that compost has to be off the ground, but I'd like in an ideal world to have maybe a bank of clay against the outside of the walls, which will create a pathway for soil biology such as worms to get in to break down the compost. Okay, let's push on. Thank you. So that completes the initial preparation of the support structure. What I'm going to do next is do a very simple frame. I'm going to use some fence posts, some bits of scrap wood, and some cable ties that I have for the trees. I'm going to punch some holes in the 4-inch pipe, and after the wood chip and the chicken manure goes in, a day or two later, I'll pull these out, and that should create air vents to try and maintain an aerobic state inside the compost. So the next steps are, go gather up some soil to create an inoculation. I have to get some piping for the sump pump, and I will bring the water back up onto the compost. So here we have a well-established wild hazelnut tree. And there's one behind it as well. One there. So I'm going to collect some soil, dig down to its roots. So that's it. I'm now going to take these buckets back up to the old bathtub. Use it to inoculate the wood chip that's going in. I have some root dip left over from planting earlier this year. It's an endo-ecto mycorrhizal. And the tree seemed to do well with it, so I'm going to add it into the mix as well. Oops. Just going to mix this up. Looks like hot chocolate drink. Right, I'm going to start adding wood chip. I'm just heading over to an adjacent farm to get some chicken manure. So what I'm going to do now is work out the volume of wood chip to the volume of chicken manure to achieve a 30-to-1 carbon to nitrogen ratio. That's 14 kilos. That's 8 kilos. Okay. So the wood chip should have 50% carbon. It's probably weighing a bit heavy because it is wet, but we'll stick with 50%. So that means I've got 4 kilos of carbon in this bucket. Chicken manure will have 0.5% to 0.9% nitrogen. The wood chip will also have a little bit of nitrogen because there was some green leaf in there. So we just bump that up to like 0.1, say to 1%. So if we assume it's got the highest level of nitrogen, which is 1%, so 1% by 14 kilos is 140 grams. So I need 30 times that. So 1.4 by 3 is 4.2. That's worked out well. So in terms of volume, I need one bucket of chicken manure to one bucket of wood chip. That worked out handy. I know we need roughly the equal volume, so roughly one grape to one shovel full of manure. So an initial observation is that it's quite difficult to fill with these posts being so tall. So if you're doing this on a larger scale, the posts would have to be near the top. So I put on about 2 inches of wood chip. I'm now going to do the same for chicken manure. In case you're in any doubt, it is quite hard work. So that's the third layer of manure in. I'm now going to move these supports and then just top it up with wood chip. So for the last step, I'm going to set up the pump to recirculate the water back into the compost. So I'm going to increase the hole size to 6 mil. So I'm just going to bury it. So that's the preparation done. Irrigation appears to be working. So what happens next is I leave it for a few days to let the fungi start to establish a hyphae network, which will create rigidity in the structure. I will then remove the fence posts, and they should then leave air vents to keep the compost aerated. And if everything goes according to plan, I don't touch it then for 12, 18 months. And that's the big advantage of all of this. It's a zero-turn composting solution. And it should help create a better outcome for fungi development, because the fungi networks, the hyphae, will not be disturbed then for 18 months. If you use traditional windrow type composting, then every 3-4 weeks, you have to keep turning it to stop it going anaerobic. So for the next week, I will check the temperature. I want it to get up above 60 degrees C, ideally into about 70. And I'm hoping it'll sit there for 4, 5, 6 days and then start to taper off. When it gets down below about 25 degrees C, I will then add some worms. Specifically, I want composting worms. So day 2, the temperature is beginning to climb, so the mesophiles are doing their job. The temperature is varying depending on where you test, so I'm seeing it around 20, 22,
towards the edge, and in the center it's now gone up to about 28, 29 degrees. So it's currently gone through the mesophilic stage, and I'm going to leave the fence posts in position until it hits the thermophilic stage, because I want to try and keep heat in there. And then as soon as it gets up to about 60, 70 degrees, I'll pull the posts out. At that point then the structure should have some form of rigidity. So day five, the peak temperature is now up to 41.5 degrees. The temperature is varying between 30 and 40 degrees along the centre, and at the edge is now up to about 23 degrees. It's now day 8 and I'm going to wrap up this video. Yesterday, or on the night of day 6, I left the water pump running. It didn't shut itself off because there was too much water flowing back in to the sump. So what I've now done is I put a timer on it, so the pump will only run for 5 minutes a day. So if it doesn't fully empty, it will cut itself off. And the consequence of leaving the water circulating all night on day 6 going on to day 7 was that the temperature in the compost fell. It fell from 40 degrees to 20 degrees. So as I said, I've now put this on a timer and I've set it to go on at 9 o'clock to 5 past 9 every morning. So as the sun comes up and heats up the bacteria and the fungi, they've got some water to work with. Today the temperature is picking up again, it's back up to about 26 degrees. I think some of the things I've learned so far is don't overwater your compost. It appears to be affected by wind chill. So I think if I was doing this again, I would either pick a low sheltered spot, or I would look, I think, more about insulation around the perimeter of the compost. So what I'm going to do now is remove the stakes, just to let the compost start to breathe. And I will periodically check up on it. I'll try and track the temperature with reasonable frequency to see if it does recover from the drowning it got yesterday. Yeah, nothing's falling in, so it appears to be working. Wondering why there's a mud bath here, it's because of moving that container. So check out that video. Okay, I'm going to wrap it up here. I will periodically do some updates, so you can click on that subscribe button if you want to see how this plays out. So until next time, good luck.